Hello and welcome to this short vidcast on the issue of research planning. One of the important things to realize throughout your entire study of research methodology is that research planning is a crucial activity that every researcher has to go through. It's an exercise in trying to set up your research so that you have the best opportunity to make and generate a convincing story, if we think in terms of the meta-criteria. Planning is what smooths the way as far as possible. And it's a fair comment to say that the amount of energy a researcher has to put into planning as opposed to other activities along the way is very sizable. In some cases, I would estimate that 70% of the effort in research is invested in planning. And I want to focus my discussion on the research spiral that you've already begun to explore, this sort of sequence of stages that the researcher has to move through. And it's not always a linear process. There can be a lot of going back and forth along that spiral. Things you learned early on may influence what you do down the track. Things that emerge down the track might cause you to review and rethink decisions that you've made early on. And one of the things that's critical to understand about research planning is, in the end, it's all about choices. It's all about the choices the researcher makes in order to get to the story in the end that they want to tell. So you can almost imagine that in the planning for research, you're moving through a gigantic tree with many forks and branches. And every choice you make leads you down some different branches that offer a range of other choices. So it's kind of a cascading model, if you will, of how a researcher needs to think forward about their project. And of course, you can never guarantee that a plan will unfold without hiccups. There will always be bumps in the journey. There will always be obstacles. So some part of planning may involve the researcher being adaptive along the way. Now, one of the things that you can see in the PowerPoints that I've uploaded is that we can overlay on top of this spiral a series of kind of prompting questions that a researcher could ask themselves or would ask themselves as they engage in this planning. Now, from your point of view, it's important to understand this process from two angles. One angle is understanding what the other researchers have had to do to make it through their journey and produce something that you now have in your hands that you're reading, a published article, a thesis, or whatever. So they would have had to go through this journey. So you can visualize what they've had to do, the choices they've had to make, and if it's a very convincing article that you're reading, they will make a lot of those choices transparent and give you the reasons why those particular choices were made. The other angle is, from your perspective as a budding researcher, designing and planning your own project, thinking forward about how you would do research to resolve or solve or address a particular issue or problem that's grabbed your interest. And we investigate both of those angles through the assessment tasks in this unit. Now, along the spiral, there are a whole range of prompting questions, and some of the purposes for those questions are to get the researcher to funnel down their attention, to make some choices so that the problem that they end up with is a manageable problem. And they might do that with the assistance of reading the work of others. They might do that with talking with others, by thinking about what's going on. Whatever can be done to shape the problem, that has its influence. And we have to recognize that it's not only the researcher that can create changes or raise issues or force choices along that spiral. Key stakeholders can also have an impact on the journey around that spiral. And we've already talked about a couple of these. The notion of an ethics committee for any researcher doing research under the aegis of a university would have to have their research vetted by an ethics committee. And that committee has the power to basically tell the researcher to redesign parts of the study if it is seen that that what is currently planned is going to violate ethical principles or does not provide the right kinds of safeguards for identity and so on. They have the power to force the researcher to change what they do. Right? When you're thinking about sampling, a little bit further down on the pathway, the fact that our ethical principles give participants the right to decide whether or not they will participate or stay in the research until the end means that they have some power to force you to rethink what's going on. Gatekeepers, those people who might control access to the sources of data you want, their decision could impact on what's going on. So it's important to understand that while it's the researcher that's doing all of this planning, what the researcher is trying to do is navigate around this spiral in a way that will produce the most convincing study under the constraints that they have to operate within. And some of those constraints may be internal to themselves, others may be external, and they may be forces and influences that the researcher just has to respond to. So there's a whole series of sort of prompting trigger questions around the spiral that the researcher asks themselves. And these move from the more general, what's my problem, what are my research questions, what's gone before, to the questions about what are my guiding assumptions. And we're talking here about making deliberate choices about what your guiding assumptions will be. And it will be very critical to understand that, because that's one of those forks in the road that creates a whole host of cascading decisions rolling and following on. That's why they're called guiding assumptions. They provide guidance for the researcher for making choices downstream. And that means that some kinds of things are in as possibilities and other kinds of things are generally out. But the lesson here for you as a budding researcher is to be conscious about that choice and also to be flexible so that you don't go into your research so focused on doing research from one particular set of guiding assumptions that you ignore the existence of research along other pathways. Because keeping that balance may in fact make it easier to identify a problem space for your research, to identify that gap in the literature that you can do your research to deal with. So you can see as you read the questions all around this spiral, the kinds of thinking that the researcher is having to engage in. And choices early on, if I'm going to do a positivist study, that means that later on I will have to make decisions about things like constructs and how to measure things, how will I quantify my data. It will have implications for what kinds of data analyses I will use. It will have implications for what kind and size of sample would be best. So you can just see that simple selection of a set of guiding assumptions has a whole host of effects downstream. If I want to do an interpretive bit of research, then that cascades a whole different set of choices. It means I don't think about constructs and measurements and quantification and all that. Rather, I talk about and think about how can I get access to the perspectives of the people I'm interested in? How can I get into their head? What kind of data can I get access to? Do I talk to them? Do I read things they've produced? What do I do? And then how do I go about gathering the data? Who do I talk to? It's a sampling issue. Who do I talk to? Who is best to talk to? And then thinking about, well, how can I extract meaning from the data that I gather? How can I do this? And so every choice along the way spins off further choices. And some choices downstream may rule in or rule out certain possibilities. Now, one thing that can help the researcher in navigating through this thing is to begin from the very start to keep a research diary, to keep a written journal of the journey. And in that journal, you can record all the choices that you've made and the reasons behind the choices. Why would you want to do that? Well, number one, it allows you to put down on paper the trajectory of your thinking. And number two, having that down on paper means that can actually be a source of data that you can draw on when it comes time to write the story, because that will help you meet the expectations of the explication meta criteria, so that you know what your limitations are. You know what trade-offs you had to make, and so on. So all of that comes to bear, and the research diary can help you put that in one place. Now, one of the things that's critical to know as a follow-on from this is that at certain points along the journey, the researcher is going to want to make specific choices about methodologies, about ways of gathering data, strategies for gathering data. So I've got a mind map in there with the PowerPoint slides, and it's a mind map out of one of your readings. And it organizes different kinds of methodologies according to a classification scheme that hopefully is helpful in allowing you to visualize what the different kinds of methodologies are in terms of the kinds of data they tend to produce. And some of the methodologies are designed to be based on data gathered through face-to-face interaction, researcher to participant. Others are designed to give control over the production of data to the participant. They write their own journal, or they draw a picture or a map for you. There are some methodologies that deal with observational strategies, where the researcher doesn't necessarily directly interact with a person, but they observe, they watch, they listen, they use their senses, and record what's going on, and there are different strategies for doing that. There are strategies for how to make sense out of documents, the things that people produce as outcomes. There are strategies for measurement processes. How can we measure different kinds of constructs? What kinds of measurement systems are best to use? And then there are what we might call the experience structuring data gathering strategies, where the researcher designs some kind of system or framework within which to gather the data. And a classic instance of this, of course, is an experiment where the researcher is manipulating the environment. But that's not the only kind of framework. And there may be some kinds of experience structuring activities that even an interpretive researcher may find useful. So part of the purpose of the mind map is not only to showcase all these different methods in an organizational framework, but also to show which kinds of methodologies might be adopted from different paradigm point of views. And you'll see that a lot of them could be useful from either set of perspectives. Now, that means the researcher wouldn't necessarily use those techniques in quite the same way, and they would look for different kinds of data to come out of them, but the methodology itself would be there. The other thing the mind map helps to do is to show the fact that in many cases the researcher may use blends of methods, multiple methods, and sometimes there are natural pairings of methods that go along that can help the researcher gather the data. And that actually creates a very strong argument, and is becoming a more powerful argument nowadays, for researchers to think about using multiple methodologies in their research. If our goal is to produce convincing research, one of the things that helps convince is telling the story from more than one angle. And one way to do that is to use different kinds of methodologies to help tell the story. And oftentimes those methods might involve blends of qualitative and quantitative data. We might even do research that has a positivist component and an interpretivist component. Perfectly legitimate. And in fact, there are a whole range of ways of designing what you might call mixed methods research approaches to help create these more dynamic, much more enriched stories that can emerge from the data. And there are a whole series of designs. Some of them involve sequentially ordering, gathering of different kinds of data, and then you're bringing those stories together downstream. And the ordering and the kinds of data gathered might depend on the purpose for the research question. Some mixed methods will operate simultaneously, sort of like a navigator triangulating in space using different stars. You need more than two stars to find out where you are in space. You can't navigate with one star. The argument in mixed methods is it's difficult to tell a convincing story using one method. All right, so a lot of lessons here in terms of making choices along the research spiral. A lot of implications for the role of paradigms, and it's important to realize that as the researcher is working around the spiral and dealing with the implications of their guiding assumptions from their adopted paradigm, that with a mixed method hat in activated, one of the things we can see is that a specific set of guiding assumptions, while it may have benefits, it will also have drawbacks. It will have blind spots. And that maybe one goal for a mixed methods design is to use another approach to offset the disadvantages of your current approach. And there are tables in your materials and so on that show some of the trade-offs. If I take a positivistic approach, there are some definite benefits here. It's good for making cause-effect conclusions. Okay, it's useful for showing that when one thing changes, here's another thing that changes over here. It's useful for keeping the researcher separate from the research context, so trying to maintain that kind of objective distance. But at the same time, it has the drawback of creating artificial contexts which may not translate to real life. So it may create difficulties in taking what is learned in the research and moving it anywhere outside that research. It may be highly dependent on the quality and nature of the sample. If you have a poor sample, you're going to have a poor story. And one of the interesting things about research in the positivist paradigm is if you do get surprises, if you get unusual observations, the way the positivist researcher will tend to deal with those is to try and explain them away and remove them from the sample so they don't contaminate the story. And statistical analysis is very sensitive to weird and unusual observations. So you don't want those things clouding the story. So the tendency there is for the positives to say, if I see something really unusual or unexpected, explain it away. Deflect it. Don't include it in the major focus. If we look at interpretivist paradigm, there are advantages and disadvantages there. Some of the advantages are you can get into an area of understanding very deeply. You can get a deep understanding of what's going on from a point of view other than yours as the researcher. You can understand all of the dynamics of what's going on. But some of the drawbacks are that it's a very research effort intensive thing. It's very hard on researchers to do it. You get a massive volume of data, and there aren't a whole lot of specific tools around to help you make sense of the data. Whereas the positivistic quantitative researcher, they've got statistics to help them tell the story. Qualitative researchers, it's a much more open game, much more difficult. And one of the trade-off benefits of doing research from the interpretivist paradigm is what happens when you get surprises, unexpected data. Well, the interpretivist doesn't try and exclude those data. The interpretivist looks for those data because they help them enrich the story. So what's unusual, what's unexpected, what's weird is exactly what helps the interpretivist expand their understanding of what's going on from the perspective of the people that they're studying. So a whole range of issues to consider here as you begin to think about how the researcher moves along this journey. And you'll be looking at that from the perspective of reading the journey of someone else and seeing what aspects of that journey are there for you to understand. And you'll be doing that journey yourself when you do your own research proposal. So you get a feel for both of those. And just remember, doing research and doing it in a convincing way is really all about choices. And it's all about all of the choices, the journey of choices you make along that spiral to get to the point where you've got what you need to help you tell the story, and then you have to make some choices about how best to tell that story so that it has that convincing impact. Thank you very much.